Welcome to ChessBiz Magazine 157. The top tournaments of this issue are the Sinkerfield Cup in St. Louis, which was won by Magnus Carlsen, second Hikaru Nakamura, Levon Aronian, and fourth and last in this super strong tournament was Gata Kamsky. The last FIDE Grand Prix near Paris, which was won jointly by Boris Gelfand and Fabiano Caruana, but Fabiano should have won alone to qualify to the Canadates tournament. And so in the FIDE Grand Prix series now, Topalov won and second was Mamedyarov, both qualified to the Canadate tournaments, and Fabiano only was third. But yeah, he, of course, really is an up-and-coming very strong player, and he won the third top tournament of this issue, the King's Tournament in Bucharest alone. And yeah, finally the fourth top tournament at the European Team Cup in Rhodes, which was surprisingly won by the Czech team of Novibor. First board Navarra, then Wojtěšek and Lasnica. And by the way, Radek Wojtěšek in the German Bundesliga plays for my team, the Hamburger SK, but of course we didn't qualify for the European Club Cup. So congratulations to the team from Novibor. Okay, let's have a look at one of Fabiano's victories here against Boris Gelfand. Yeah, White should be better due to the extra pawns, but Boris has managed to start some complications. What to do with White to move? How to defend? Queen c1, this I like very much. Diagonal queen retreats are most often overlooked by humans for this type of move. And now Fabiano controls e and c file, and it's very difficult for Black to do something. And sooner or later, Black's rook can be taken. Okay, sooner. And okay, Boris still has some practical chances, but objectively, White must be winning with this extra material, and Fabiano converted convincingly. In the European Club Cup, one very important match was, of course, Soka against Novibor. Here's second board, Veselin Topalov, Radek Wojtěšek. What to do with Black to move? How to continue the attack? Invite everyone to the party, and so the sleeping knights are coming. Okay, one knight is lost, but it doesn't matter. It's still a nightmare for White. Black is winning with now all his pieces in the attack. And this was a very important match victory, of course, for the Czech team. There are three opening videos. Boykov has still continues to look at the Sicilian second in the second move e6 and then b3 from White's point of view, and this is a third and fourth pass of this video lectures. And Alexey Shirov has contributed two videos, one of his Bundesliga game against Ipatov, which was a Queen's Gambit exchange with knight g e2, and Alexey really also looks at the opening subtleties and so study this. And I think Queen's Gambit with knight g exchange with knight g e2 is quite dangerous for Black. And he also looks at his World Cup game against Hu Jifan. It was again a Queen's Gambit, and this time Black played bishop b4. I think it's called Rogozin variation, but I'm not 100% sure. But okay, look at Shirov's video analysis, which is much more precise. Anyway, there are 12 surveys, opening surveys in traditional format. A new author, Max Illingworth from Australia, looks at an idea from Kramnik in the Catalan opening from White's point of view. And another new author is Dejan Antic. And he looks at a really dangerous new idea in the Boguinian main line. So Boguinian main line with knight bd2. Yeah, this is all well known. Okay, so far, so good. And now comes the point. H4, really amazing. And this is very dangerous for Black. I think Black doesn't like this at all because now, due to the threat, Bishop takes H7 check. Black must deal with the probes and the king side, and this he doesn't want. By the way, all three surveys I want to show you here in more detail deal with a very early white H2, H4. Chess really is a rich game, and such trend and openings always keep cropping up, and this is, of course, very good for the game not to get stuck in some typical mo certain kind of motives. Always fresh ideas. Yeah, and here I think these H2, H4 ideas in the three surveys have slightly different objective merits, but okay, it's a bit subjective. Here I think H4 is really very, very dangerous. I like very much. Because there Black doesn't want to react. Okay, Antich now looks at G6, F5, and H6, but all have disadvantages somehow. Bishop B1 to bring the queen to the attack. Yeah, this all looks very logical. White just keeps bringing the pieces to the attack. And now comes another extremely dangerous and deep point from Kapnisis, Markidis Patras 2013. The amazing bishop takes h6. Okay, in the game now, the knight takes c5 was played. Antich gives you some homework, and yeah, you can count yourself lucky that I've done some homework for you already. Here he thinks that white is more than enough compensation, and I did the homework for you. I agree. Knight 1 h2, and yeah, this gives white more than sufficient compensation for the piece. Just, yeah. Black's pieces have no harmony. So here I think that the move h4 may cast some doubt on Black's whole mainline concept. But of course, only the future can tell if Black has sufficient resources or not. But if there are even possibilities like bishop takes h6 in this position, I start to get doubt about Black's whole concept. But okay, who knows? In the next survey by Krasenkov, the idea h4 against the Dutch Leningrad system is, of course, known for a longer time. It's not so original, but still dangerous, as Nakamura Baron Toronto 2009 shows. Here it can be seen what happens if Black doesn't take White's idea seriously. And yeah, these must be very, very dangerous. Black has an extra exchange, but this is the end of the good news. The king is open, white has a good advantage in development, and this, yeah, it's extremely dangerous, and Hikaru Nakamura won a nice attacking game. So I think critical is the following, also said by Krasenkov. Okay, here a different move order was used, but yeah. Okay, that move order business I don't want to go into here. And now d6. This, I think, is critical. And then the resulting position from Dirk Paulsen, Manfred Heidrich, German Bundesliga, is the following. Okay, it's a bit. But okay, the king finds a safe harbor. And now d5 is wrong. I agree with Krasenkov. This is one critical possibility. And then white has some compensation. But it's not clear if sufficient or not. Here I am not so confident or sure. Here h4 can be played, but yeah, it gives messy complications, and then it is not such position here is not clear, and I'm not so optimistic than in the previous survey. And then comes Postny's survey, and here h4 is even played against the Grünfeld Indian, believe it or not. But of course, Grünfeld Indian, and now comes h4 and Mamedyarov, Vashila Graf, Grand Prix, Grand Slam, final 2013. Ja, here I am not so optimistic. Here I think this might go a bit too far. Yeah, and this is also, I of course again had to delete most of the annotations due to the space limitations of the video format, but in principle, Posny also seems to think that this gives black good play. And now the knight takes, and somehow it's a bit hard to believe that white really should go for this against the green field. Yeah, this here's too much play in the center already somehow. I think that it is a bit might be a bit optimistic for white. But again, it was 8-4, so three of the service, and yeah, all very fascinating. And yeah, you can find maybe you can try yourself if you believe in one of the ideas. And then against the Bogo Indian, I think it is really very dangerous. While here, it is very original, but probably a bit too optimistic somehow. Okay. Next come the columns. There are Daniel King in his move by move column looks at Sergej Cigalko, Marijn van Delft from the European Club Cup. And by the way, Marijn van Delft in the German Bundesliga also plays for my team, Hamburger SK, like Radek Vojtěch. But we didn't qualify for the European Club Cup. And it is a wide attack in the Sicilian with c3 in the second move. And really try to answer all of Daniel's questions in the new interactive Fritz Trainer video format yourself first. Only like this you will profit from the new interactive format. Dolia Rogozenko looks at an extremely important strategic concept in his strategy column, the prophylaxis. Really, what was the idea of the last move of your opponent? What is your opponent threatening? What is he planning? Or in an endgame, might he even be in some sort of Zugzwang? This is very, very important. So what to do in Vitjugov-Vorobyov Russian Championship Higher League 2007 with white to move? What is black threatening? And this really is a very important question you should ask yourself, of course, during the H4. G7, G5 is prevented. White gains space on the king side, has a bishop pair, has space for the king, and somehow white must be better here. But it was very important to stop black's play. Otherwise, if the initiative would turn around, then it could be different. But here, of course, white must be better, and prophylaxis is really an extremely important concept, and I like how Dorian Rogozenko manages to connect the past to the present and maybe even the future. So really study his strategy column. In the tactics column, Oliver Ray looks at central strikes and beautiful black victories, and I want to show one example from the central strikes, one typical Salem gegen Barros, Riva de Naira, World Championship Under 20, Coachella 2013. What to do with white to move, and it's a very typical central strike in this kind of structure you should know. It's an inve also, of course, a strategic theme. E5, very important. White opens roads, the pawn cannot take, and if the queen takes, then white profits a lot from the opened road. The e4 pawn was in white's way anyway, and now white has extremely strong pressure on the dark squares. Yes, very. Yeah, I really like e5, of course. The pawn was in the way anyway. And such typical strategical or tactical motifs you should know, of course. Yeah, there are not so many pawn structures after all, and then some typical ways, the levers and motifs, yeah, are worth, definitely worth knowing. In the endgame column, I look at Capablanca's theorem. Queen and knight are a strong attacking duo, or are better than queen and bishop. But they must have an additional advantage. They are not better from, yeah, okay, they are slightly less redundant, but still they are not better. They need at least one additional advantage. Okay, I will deal this in more detail there. But this example I like very much. Gardili gegen Nisipiano, Dubai 2002. Black to move and win. From Valerie Bein's book, How to Calculate Chess Tactics. What to do with black to move? Queen e5 check, or Queen g1 check, or something else first. In the game, Queen g1 check was played, and Livio Di Danisepiano later won anyway, and it's probably it still wins, but a2 is much better, because now whites must take with one of the defenders, and then black chooses the appropriate winning line. If the queen takes, then this mates, and I really like it. Black has only two attackers, but queen and knight cooperate so wonderful that there's no defense left. So they're really a strong attacking duo if the circumstances are right. And if the bishop takes, then yeah, the bishop doesn't protect g6 anymore, and now the line from the game directly wins. So a2 would have been stronger, but it's of course easy to miss over the board. Last not least comes the opening trap by Rainer Knaack from the Accelerated Dragon. Here's, for example, Kari Honfi, Alexander Zaitsev, Hungary versus the RSFSR in Budapest 1963. Okay, Accelerated Dragon, one of the main lines. Yeah, and now this is some kind of trap, or the trapper might catch himself, it's not so, or herself or himself, it's not so easy to say, but this is your exercise now. Knight a5. Is this good or bad? If the bishop retreats, then it's probably good, but what about bishop takes f7? Does white then trap black, or is it the other way around? Calculate it, make a judgment, would you play it or not, and only afterwards look at Rainer Knaack's solution on the DVD. And now I wish you a lot of fun with Chess with Magazine 157.